Hello, friends. Welcome to the Finished Work Eschatology series, the vlog number 39 in the series, and this subtitled Five Wise and Five Foolish. Now, the Five Wise and Five Foolish does not come from Matthew 24, which has been the focus of this vlog series. It comes from Matthew 25. However, I think once you have an elementary understanding of Matthew 24, you will, I think, have an easier time with this first story from Matthew 25. If you do not have a real understanding of Matthew 24, then there are some pretty interesting slash dangerous things we can do with Matthew 25. I'll start there. Matthew 25 has for a long time, and this guy right here, one of the biggest ducks in the pond, as they say, been treated as a standalone story about a futuristic rapture. And if you do that, in which there are 10 virgins, 5 wise, 5 foolish, 5 are ready, 5 are not, 5 have oil in their lamps, 5 don't. If you do that, then you're going to open up a world of theological problems, as you have the virgins, who in the futurist interpretation of the chapter all represent the church, and you're going to have half the church ready to go and half not ready to go, because half have the Holy Spirit and half don't have the Holy Spirit. That's what we would always say the oil represented. And the half that are ready won't share with the half that are not, and the half that are not have laid around and slumbered and slept, and we'll call that sin, and been lazy and won't evangelize the world. Then when the quote-unquote rapture happens, there's enough time somehow for those who are not being raptured to stop and ask those who are if they could have some of their oil, and they say, no, you got to go buy some, which then leads to the theological issue of how do you go buy the Holy Spirit if the oil is the Holy Spirit, and if it's not the Holy Spirit, what is it they're buying and how do you buy it? Why does half of them have it and half of them don't? If you continue with this line of teaching, you end up with a very hard theology, which is, and this is how literal some people are taking these scriptures, you end up with a theology in which when the Lord returns, half of the church is saved and half of the church is unsaved. And so that allows you to conclude every sermon at the end of every service by an invitation. Forget whether or not there's any sinners in the house. You can extend that invitation to 100% of the Christians, because odds are half of you aren't even saved anyway. You think you are, but you're slumbering and sleeping, and it's time this church gets serious, because the Lord's going to come back and half of you are going to be left behind. I hope that you can see how many roads that this chapter can take you down if you miss the first word. I don't even mean the first verse. If you miss the first word of Matthew 25, verse 1, then you are really going to have a problem with a lot of theology that is going to happen in Matthew 25. Let's read that first word. We're going to do more than that, but we'll start there. Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. The timing of Matthew 25 is in the immediate timing of Matthew 24. Jesus does not say the kingdom of heaven is likened. That would be a statement that he makes when he talks about the kingdom of heaven is like a man who goes out into the field and he finds the pearl of great price and he buys it, sells all that he has so that he can buy it. Or the kingdom of heaven is like a woman that drops 3 measures of leaven in a meal, a measure of leaven in meal, and then the whole loaf rises. The kingdom of heaven is like a seed planted in the ground, and a great tree grows, and all of the fowls of the air nestle in its branches. Jesus doesn't put those out in the future. He talks about that's what the kingdom is like. But when he gets to Matthew 25, then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins. So he's timing the 25th chapter of Matthew within the context of the events that are happening in the 24th chapter of Matthew, which we've spent 38 vlogs telling you, are within the lifetime of his audience. So what I want to do now is read the 13 verses that encompass the parable of the wise and the foolish virgins, or what is more commonly referred to as the five wise and the five foolish. So bear with me and maybe follow along. I'll read from the New King James. It's just more familiar to many of our ears. Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. Think of this as I read it. Think of it, and some of you, this will be the first time you've ever thought of it this way. Don't think of this as a story that we need to get up and preach this Sunday on salvation. Think of this within the context and confines of Matthew 24 and the pending judgment on Jerusalem in AD 70. Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Now five of them were wise and five were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight a cry was heard, "Behold, the bridegroom is coming, go out to meet him." Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise answered, saying, "No, lest there should not be enough for us and you, but go rather to those who sell and buy for yourselves." And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the wedding, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he answered and said, "Assuredly, I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming." Now, I think as we read that, and we keep in mind the 24th chapter of Matthew, in which the coming of the Son of Man is the real pericope of that chapter, it's the focus, then I think we begin to see that Jesus has not suddenly changed audiences and started talking about the futuristic church and how half of them will be lost and half of them will be saved, but rather he's still focusing on the same group of people. To prove it, we just simply need to determine if the language that Jesus is using in Matthew 25 would have been familiar to a Jewish audience as dealing with them rather than some future church. And I think from the very beginning, when Jesus says the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom, that we have definitely isolated Israel and the system of their Mosaic economy as the focus of the next story. One of the reasons why is that the Bible tells us in Isaiah that Israel is clothed as a bride adorned for the bridegroom. So we see the bridegroom imagery in relation to Israel. But we also see the virgin imagery in relation to Israel. And I just want to read a couple. There are several. I want to read two of the most glaring ones to you. You go back to the tiny little minor prophet, minor only in size, not in importance, of Amos. And Amos writes in Amos chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, "Hear this word which I take up against you, a lamentation, O house of Israel. The virgin of Israel has fallen. She will rise no more. She lies forsaken on her land. There is no one to raise her up." Now, we surely are not talking about the virgin that will bear the Messiah. That's obvious. That reference is only in Isaiah. The virgin of Israel has fallen. She will rise no more. She lies forsaken on her land. There's no one to raise her up. This is a lamentation of God towards the house of Israel. Did you notice that he calls her a virgin? Jeremiah, what we would refer to as a major prophet. Again, not so much in importance, though he was certainly important as much as in the size of his work. I want to start in verse 3 of Jeremiah 31. We'll read 3 and 4. "The Lord has appeared of old to me, saying, 'Yes, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness, I have drawn you. Again, I will build you, and you shall be rebuilt, O virgin of Israel, You shall again be adorned with your tambourines and shall go forth in the dances of those who rejoice. We'll stop there. Again, God rebuilding his people, which he does after their tragic fall in at the hands of the Babylonians, the Medes and the Persians, here in this Old Testament book of Jeremiah. But there's another reference to Israel as virgins. Now, if you need more, I'm not going to read them all. You can go get your commentary and look this word up, and you'll find that it is also maiden or maid in the Bible. But if you want to specifically see references to Israel as the virgin, you can do so in the book of Isaiah, you can do so in the book of Lamentations, and you can do so in the book of 2 Kings. Now, that is five different Old Testament witnesses. And remember, the scriptures that the disciples had at their disposal were Old Testament scriptures. There are five different Old Testament references to Israel being the virgin. So, seeing that Jesus is speaking to the same people in Matthew 25 as he was in Matthew 24, and again, I think it's worth throwing in here, my intention is not to go through Matthew 25 in the same manner that I went through Matthew 24, but I didn't feel like this 40-episode vlog series was complete without this vlog. Because I, for one, have played a lot of theological calisthenics in my ministerial career with the five wise and the five foolish. In particular, right after I came into the message of grace, I had not had a change in my eschatology. I was still dispensationalist, but I was really struggling with the dispensational side of my theology because I had a God who wasn't angry and who had finished the work on the cross, and yet I couldn't reconcile this future judgment against the whole world. I knew about AD 70, and I thought, well, Israel, for having done what they did at the cross, definitely needed that. But I didn't understand where the judgment scriptures fell in the scripture. And so when I would preach and there's a sermon probably still floating around out there somewhere of me dealing in my early days of the grace message with the five wise and the five foolish. And I spent so much time in that message trying to reconcile all the little symbols in the story with New Testament doctrines about the Spirit. And where I ran into a lot of problems was the five foolish that didn't have the oil. If the oil was the Spirit, how were they even virgins? How were they saved, is how I would have said it, without the Holy Spirit? How was there time for them to ask for a portion of the spirit that the five wise had? Why were the five wise so stingy? Why didn't they share their spirit? And if the Holy Spirit can't be exhausted, what would it have hurt to have taken out of their vessel and put into someone else's? So I did a lot of calisthenics. I did a little Old Testament. I'm not even going to go through it, but I did a little reference into the Old Testament of an obscure scripture about buying, and how that was the word of God, and how you did that by taking the word, and all these people had to do was look in the word and they could have found their redemption. What I didn't realize was I was really preaching to myself. If I had just looked into the word, and instead of confining my sermon to Matthew 25, if I just backtracked a little bit and try to figure out when the kingdom of heaven was actually going to take place, the scripture calisthenics would not have been necessary to figure out how they buy oil and things of that nature. And so I want to say this, the story of the five wise and five foolish should be taken within the context of Matthew 24. So what Jesus is doing is he's giving you another metaphor. He's not trying to lay out all of these little intricate details about salvation, half the church saved, half the church unsaved. No. He's saying, I want to liken the kingdom in that day to a Jewish wedding ceremony. And these are waiting for the arrival of the bridegroom to begin the ceremony to start the party. But all of them slumber and sleep because for some reason there's a delay. The bridegroom is not able to be there. And so in the meantime, half of them have their extra oil so that they can endure the delay. They take extra oil because they know that it might be a while the rest of them don't bother because they don't think anything of it. And then they go out to meet the bridegroom, and half are prepared and half are not. And so then they go, when the bridegroom arrives, only half are able to go in with him because only half are really ready. So he uses a story, a metaphor. And I've heard it preached, you know, I'm going to walk you through the Jewish wedding ceremony and what this virgin means and what the oil means. And I think we're missing the point. Jesus is telling the same story with a different twist. He just told you the faithful servant and the evil servant at the end of Matthew 24. Now he tells you five wise and five foolish virgins because these are stories that Jews could have understood. And one of the areas that is of very high importance in this story is the fact that in verse 10, they go into the wedding chamber with the bridegroom, the door is shut, then those foolish come back and can't get in. So access into the kingdom of heaven in this story is the receiving of the bridegroom when he comes. And according to Matthew 24, this is a coming in judgment. And for those who are prepared for it, they enter into the fullness of the kingdom age with Jesus. Those who are not prepared for it were left out in the cold. And of course, according to Matthew 24, we're going to see some of them are going to be taken and some of them not. Some of them are going to be ready and some of them not. Those who heed the words of Jesus to flee to the mountains of Judea would be ready. Where I run into problems when I was preaching this and teaching this through a dispensational lens is, I taught it as a rapture, but the problem was the bridegroom doesn't come and take the five wise away and leave the five foolish and then kill the five foolish. But rather, the bridegroom shows up and the five wise stay with him. Now, they enter a chamber together. This is the same chamber that I believe, in some respects, it's the chamber of the kingdom, Jesus, the way into the Father, that Jesus talks about the place prepared for his disciples. And it's not a physical place. He didn't take them away to heaven. He entered into the kingdom era with them, which is exactly what happened when he had eradicated that old system, that old Mosaic economy. And so as a dispensational story, it falls apart in many places, the oil, the five, et cetera, but it really runs into a problem with the bridegroom comes, they go into the chamber, and everybody else is standing outside wanting to get in. He doesn't take them away. And that also led some to be post-trib. They would say, well, you know, you're not, when the tribulation happens, then he'll come and dwell with us and all the others will be dead and it won't matter. And we get into a lot of bizarre things when we go down that road. So again, I would encourage you to re-examine the 13 verses that open the 25th chapter of Matthew, and please do so in relation to the 24th chapter of Matthew. I would also say, it is best to never just read that 25th chapter by itself. Read it with its link up with that 24th chapter. And next week, I'm going to deal with some of the issues of rapture and things of that nature as we sort of put a bow on this topic in our eschatology vlog series. We'll start a new vlog series very soon, but I want to try to deal with a couple of little issues that have come up over the course of 39 weeks, a lot of questions. I won't be able to answer them all, but there's been a lot wanting me to cover this or cover that. I want to tell you, a lot of people took a couple of vlogs ago where I said our viewership went down. A lot of people took that as I was discouraged, and I probably came across that way, and I apologize. I was not, and I am not discouraged. I completely understand. Some didn't get what they want, so they left. Others got what they want, and it put them on the road. I got a testimony from a man just the other day who wrote us an amazing email that said, this has literally changed my life. I did not know any of this before this vlog started, and you have taken me down a road that makes everything else make so much sense. Well, I don't know that that's what I was trying to do. What I was really trying to do is let the 24th chapter of Matthew speak for itself without all the outside noises. I think once we can silence those noises, it will speak for itself. And then if that leads you into freedom and victory, praise God. That is certainly what we hope to accomplish. So that's it for vlog 39. Hope you've been encouraged, been blessed. I'll see you for the final vlog. At least that's my thoughts right now. That could change. For vlog 40 next week. God bless.